my dear learners, for this course on design of machine elements 1. In this module 3, we were discussing about design of shafts, keys and couplings. In our previous lecture, we have solved two problems on design of shafts. The question bank which I am solving is attached through a link given below this video in the description. Kindly use that link to get access to the question bank. For that question bank, we are discussing the solution in this lecture series. Continuing our discussion on design of shafts, the problem number 3 of our discussion states that a shaft is supported by two bearings placed 1 meter apart. A 500 mm diameter pulley is mounted at a distance of 200 mm to the right of left hand bearing, and this drives a pulley directly below it with the help of belt having maximum tension of 3000 newtons. The pulley weighs 1000 newton. Another pulley 300 mm diameter is placed 300 mm to the left of right hand bearing, is driven with the help of an electric motor and a belt with horizontally to the right when viewed from the left bearing. This pulley weighs 500 newton. The angle of contact for both the pulleys is 180 degrees and coefficient of friction is 0.24. Determine the suitable diameter for the solid shaft, assuming torque on one pulley is equal to the torque on another pulley. Choose C15 steel whose yield strength is 235.4 MPa, ultimate strength is 425 MPa as the shaft material, and use ASME code for the design of shaft. Assume minor shock conditions. We have a shaft mounted between the bearings, which is somewhat like singly supported beam, on which we have two pulleys. Now to understand this problem clearly, first I should draw the space diagram. Let me draw the space diagram and distort the data given for this problem. So if we draw the space diagram for this problem, we have under design of shafts, we are discussing problem number 3, for which if I draw the space diagram, we have a bearing . The distance between these two bearings is specified, which is 1 meter apart. On this, we have a final diameter pulley is mounted at a distance of 200 mm to the right of left hand bearing. So this is left hand bearing and this is right hand bearing. To the right of left hand bearing at a distance of 200 mm, we have a pulley whose diameter is 500 mm. The diameter of this pulley is 500 mm. This drives a pulley directly below. Let me mark it once I decide the direction of view. And another pulley of 300 mm diameter is placed 300 mm to the left of right hand bearing. So to the left of right hand bearing at a distance of 300 mm, we have one more pulley whose diameter of this pulley is 300 mm. So let me mark it as points A and B are the supports or bearings. And we have pulley BC and D. In order to avoid confusion, I am neglecting BD. I am giving notation as D. This pulley is driven by electric motor and a belt which is placed horizontally to the right when viewed from the left hand bearing. The view is from left hand bearing, so therefore mark the view. View is from left hand bearing. So when viewed from left hand bearing, the 300 mm diameter bearing is driven by an electric motor directly towards right side. But if you clearly observe, when viewed from left hand bearing, this larger diameter pulley will come first. So therefore, this smaller pulley will become invisible. So if I draw that, I will get, we have a larger diameter pulley inside which we have a smaller diameter pulley. This is 500 mm diameter pulley. The larger pulley is driven vertically downwards, whereas the smaller pulley, that is 300 mm diameter pulley, is driven by a electric motor horizontally to the right when viewed from left hand bearing. So let us mark the tensions as TC1, TC2, TE1 and TE2 are the belt tensions. Apart from that, we have weight of the pulleys. So weight of the inside pulley is given to us. It could be 300 mm diameter, weighs 500 Newton, and the larger diameter pulley, that is weight of pulley C, is also specified. Weight of pulley C is 1000 Newtons. This is weight of pulley E. Data given for us, we have drawn the space diagram first. Now, with the help of this space diagram and the data given for us are overall length, I can mark in the space diagram itself, overall length is 1 meter, which is nothing but 1000 millimeters. All dimensions are in mm. We have diameter of pulley C as 500 mm. The marking is already made. It is at a distance of 200 mm to the right of left hand bearing, and it drives a pulley directly below it, marked. With the help of belt having a maximum tension, that is TC1, is specified as 3000 Newtons, and weight of this pulley WC is also specified. Weight of pulley C is 1000 Newtons. We have one more pulley, that is pulley E, whose diameter is 300 mm. It's placed 300 mm to the left of right hand bearing, already shown. It is driven with the help of electric motor and a belt which is placed horizontally to the right when viewed from left hand bearing. It is also marked. This pulley weighs 500 Newton. So weight of pulley E is also specified. It is weighing 500 Newtons. The angle of contact for both the pulleys is 180 degrees. Theta is specified as 180 degrees, but I should substitute theta in terms of radians. Coefficient of friction is 0.24 for both. Remaining suitable diameter for the shaft. Use AXN standards. The material is C15 steel, whose yield stress is 235.4 pascals, and ultimate strength is 425 megapascals, assuming minor shocks. So this is the data given, and also I have marked the space diagram. Let us solve this problem. Now, yes, not specified power and RPM of the power transmission. He has specified the maximum tension for pulley C, and also he has given one thing, that is torque on pulley 1 is equal to torque on pulley 2. That is, torque on pulley C is equal to the torque on pulley E. So it is a one more hint he has specified. Now, if I use the three equations of pulley, as I said, the procedure to be followed for design of shaft is that first I should draw the space diagram. Second, I should find out the forces. Third step, I should find out the bending moment. And finally, I should calculate the diameter. So first step is done. I have laid on the space diagram and I have understood the problem. And also I have detected what are the direction of forces acting. Now moving for the second step, I should find the magnitude of forces. To determine the magnitude of forces, we have only pulleys mounted on this shaft. So therefore, whenever we have a pulley mounted on the shaft, I already explained we have three equations for pulley. If I consider pulley C, so pulley C is the larger one whose diameter is 500 mm, he himself has been stated that it drives another pulley below it, so therefore this is a driver. This is a driver pulley which is driving vertically from below the another pulley. Therefore we have three equations. Equation 1 is torque is equal to 9.55 into 10 to the power of 6 into P by N. So first equation cannot be employed for this problem because he has not specified power and RPM. So move for the second equation. The second equation is T1 by T2 is equal to P to the power of mu theta. And third equation, we already know that MT is also equal to T1 minus T2 into radius of the pulley. So first equation cannot be used, we can use second and third equation. So coming for the second equation, if I use, we know that TC1 by TC2 is equal to e to the power of mu theta. So TC1 is given to us, which is 3000 newtons. I should calculate TC2, which is equal to mu is specified as 0.24 into theta is 180 degrees. I should substitute it in radians, so therefore it will become 180 into pi by 180 radians. So if I solve, I get the value of TC2 as TC2 is equal to 1411.468 newtons. So thereby I calculated both the forces. Now I can find the torque. So therefore torque MT is equal to TC1 minus TC2 into radius of pulley C. So therefore torque on pulley C will be 3000 minus answer into radius of pulley C is 250 mm. So torque is 3971.09 Nm. We have calculated the torque to be transmitted. So therefore for pulley C, horizontal force is 0, total vertical force will be plus TC2 plus weight of the pulley. So therefore we have only vertical force for pulley C whose magnitude is equal to 3000 plus 1411.468 plus weight of pulley C is 1000. So total vertical force is 5411.468 newtons. So similarly, if I solve for pulley B, pulley, in order to avoid confusion, I am using it as pulley E, which is a driven pulley, which is driven by a motor horizontally to the right when viewed from left hand bearing. So for this also I should use the three equations of pulleys, in which the first equation cannot be used. But for this, the torque remains same, is the given data for us. So therefore MTC is equal to MTE is the given data for us. So I have two equations and two unknowns. I can solve this. So use second and third equation for pulley E to find the belt tensions of pulley E. So the first equation will become TE1 by TE2 is equal to e to the power of 0.24 into 180 into pi by 180. So therefore I get one equation as, which is equal to 2.125. So if I multiply and take inside, I'll get 2 minus 2.125 TE2 is equal to 0. Let us take it as equation 1. So we have another equation, that is from equation 3, I can also write it as TE1 minus TE2 is equal to MT by radius of pulley E. So therefore, TE1 minus TE2 is equal to torque. We have already calculated, it is 397133.09 divided by radius of pulley E is 150 millimeters. So therefore, I will get the answer as 2647.55, take it as equation. So solving equation 1 and 2, I will get the values of TE1 and TE2 as 1 is 5000.93 newtons on the slack side, the tension is 2353.38 newtons. Now for pulley E, it is driven horizontally to the right from a motor, so therefore we have both horizontal and vertical forces. The horizontal force is TE1 plus TE2, which will be equal to 5000.93 plus 2353.38, which is turning out to be 7354.31 newtons. Coming for vertical force, we have only weight of pulley E, which is given as 500 newtons. So now, to mark the load diagram, I should mark the direction here itself. There is no horizontal force, no worries. Vertical force is acting vertically downwards. So this is vertically downwards, I should mark. Coming for pulley E, we have horizontal force 7354.31 newtons. If I view from left hand bearing, the load is acting towards right, since the force is acting away from the observer. As I said in my first lecture of design of shaft, if the load in the horizontal plane acts away from the observer, mark it as vertically downwards in the horizontal force diagram. So therefore, I should mark this as vertically downwards in horizontal force diagram. In horizontal force diagram, I should mark it as vertically downwards because that force is moving away from the observer. This way always acts vertically downwards. So we know magnitude, we know the directions, so therefore I can mark it in the load diagram. So let me use different chalk to mark load diagram and bending moment. So we have 4 points to mark. Now we already marked the space diagram. First let me take vertical force diagram, VFD. So if I mark the vertical force diagram, we have the plane on which the forces acting are, we have supports, so therefore we get support reactions RA and RB. At pulley C, the vertical force is 5411.5 newtons. At pulley E, the force is 500 newtons. So similarly, if I mark horizontal force diagram or horizontal load diagram, horizontal force diagram. So in the horizontal force diagram also we have the support, same supports RA horizontal and RB horizontal. Let me mark it as vertical to differentiate. at point C, from pulley C, we don't have any force, so therefore force is zero. Coming for pulley E, the horizontal force is 7354. I should mark it as vertically downwards because it is moving away from the observer, whose magnitude is 7354.3. Now, let me pause this video for a while so that people can copy it down. Later we will solve for bending moments. Now, coming for vertical force diagram, we should calculate vertical bending moment. And using horizontal force diagram, we should calculate horizontal bending moment, using which I should calculate the resultant bending moment, from which I can extract the maximum bending moment for the given operating conditions. So therefore, using vertical force diagram, let me calculate vertical bending moments. Since we have simply supported beam, so for simply supported beam, we should analyze from left to right, considering forces acting upwards as positive, forces acting downwards as negative, and also considering clockwise movements as positive and counterclockwise moments as negative. So recalling the basics, let me start calculating it. The first step is to find the support reactions. So therefore, summation of vertical forces should be equal to zero. So thereby, I'll get RA vertical plus RB vertical is equal to 5411.5 plus 500 as one equation, and let us take moment about right support as 0. Next we have summation of moment about right support, that is DV is equal to 0. If I do that, I will get RA vertical into distance is 1000 mm minus 5411.5 into distance will be 800 minus 500 into distance will be 300. This must be equal to 0. So thereby find the value of RA vertical. So RA vertical will become, RA vertical is turning out to be 4479 newtons. So hence, substituting this in the above equation, I can find the value of RB vertical. So therefore, RB vertical will be sum of this minus RA vertical, that is 5411.5 plus 500 minus RA vertical is 4479, which is equal to 1432.5 newtons. So moment at A vertical will be 0. Moving for point C and point E, point C and point E. Coming for moment at point C vertical is equal to RA vertical into distance is 200. Coming for RE vertical will be Ra vertical into distance will be 700 minus 5411.5 into the distance between these two will be 500. So let me calculate the value, and finally bending moment about point B vertical should be equal to 0. You want, you can calculate and verify. Now if I calculate the values, we have RA vertical as 4479 into distance is 200. So you get the answer as 895800. Newton millimeters. Coming for bending moment at point E in the vertical load diagram, I will get RA vertical is 4479 into distance is 700 minus 5411.5 into 500. I am getting the answer as 429550 millimeters. So this completes the calculation for vertical bending moments. Let me move for horizontal bending moment using the first condition, that is summation of force acting horizontally should be equal to 0. So from the horizontal force diagram we will get Ra horizontal plus Rb horizontal should be equal to 7354 newtons. So now taking moment about right support and equating to 0, that is bending moment Rbh equal to 0, I can find the value of Rah, that is Rah into 1000 minus 7354 into 300. This must be equal to 0, hence I will get Rah as, so therefore from the above equation you can calculate Rbh. So Rah will be, that is 2206 newtons, and Rbh will be 7354 minus 2206, which is 5148 newtons. Now I know all the forces in the horizontal force diagram, so therefore I can calculate the bending moments. So coming for horizontal bending moments, the first one is bending moment at A horizontal, this must be equal to 0. Moving for bending moment at C horizontal is equal to Ra horizontal into the distance between them is 200. So therefore Ra horizontal is known 2206 into 200. So it is turning out to be 441200 newton millimeters. Moving for point E horizontal, the bending moment will be Ra horizontal into 700 minus Rc. So we don't have any force at point C, that's it. So this is equal to 2206 into 700 is the distance, which is turning out to be 15442200 newton millimeters, and moment about B horizontal must be equal to 0. So we have calculated both vertical bending moments and horizontal bending moments. Now I can calculate the resultant bending moments. We know that resultant bending moments MR is equal to moment horizontal square plus moment vertical square under the root. So if I do for A, it is 0. If I do for C, we have square root of, if I do for C, we have square root of 89,58,00 square plus horizontal is 44,12,00 square. I am getting moment about C as 998,556.5 newton millimeters. If I do for moment about point E, I will get square root of vertical is 429,550 square plus horizontal is 154,420 square. So I will get the answer as 1602.8809 newton millimeters and moment about point B is 0. From which I can conclude that moment about E is the maximum, so therefore this is the maximum bending moment. So this long process what we have done is only to find this value. So this is what I require. The maximum bending moment for this problem is 1602.831 newton millimeters. So we know all the bending moments. Let me complete the drawing. Let me draw the horizontal and vertical bending moments and also the resultant bending moment. If I do that, I will get, so we have the shaft. So first we have vertical bending moment diagram, VBMD, vertical bending moment diagram, for which at A we have the moment as 0, at point C the moment is 895,800, which is higher, so therefore I will take it as higher value. You know that for point load the variation of bending moment is linear. 895,800, and next it drops down to 429,550. And then it turns out to be 0. So we got the vertical bending moment diagram. Next, moving for HPMD, that is horizontal bending moment diagram. Horizontal bending moment diagram. So initially we have 0, then we have 998,556.5. That is 998,556. And then it is increased to 1602.831. Sorry, I am plotting for resultant instead of horizontal bending moment diagram. It is 441,200. And then it is 1544,200. And it is turning to be 0. So thereby I have completed the R is under bending moment diagram also. So now I can plot the resultant bending moment diagram, that is RBM, resultant bending moment diagram. So coming for resultant bending moment diagram, here let's see, we have 998557. At point E we have 160.2831. So this is the answer what I required. This completes the horizontal and vertical force diagrams and horizontal and vertical bending moment diagrams and finally the resultant bending moment diagram. Let me pause this video for a while so that you people can copy it down. Now we know all the values, that is maximum torque and maximum bending moment. Now I can find the diameter. Now, moving ahead to determine the diameter, we can solve either by using maximum shear stress theory or by using maximum normal stress theory. Let me solve by both and adopt the larger value for safe design. But he has not given the tau allowable or sigma allowable for this problem. But he has asked us to solve by using ASME standards. Now, from ASME standards, we know that according to ASME standards, we know that tau max is equal to 0.3 times the yield, and also tau max is equal to 0.18 times sigma ultimate. I should adopt minimum among these values, so therefore I can adopt tau max, and then considering keyway effect, 25% of the strength will be reduced, which I have clearly explained in our lecture 1 of this module. If you have forgotten, kindly visit that lecture 1 and come back. So from first equation, tau max will be 0.3 into yield stress is 235.4, which is turning out to be 70.62. For this we have 0.18 into sigma ultimate is 425, which is turning out to be 76.5. So therefore minimum among these two is 70.62. Now considering keyway effect, allowable shear stress is 25% of tau max. Therefore 70.62 into 0.25 is nothing but, sorry, 25% is lost, so remaining is 75%. Which is equal to 52.965 MPa. We can take it as 53 megapascals and solve. So similarly for maximum normal stress theory, we have sigma max is equal to 0.6 times sigma yield, and also sigma max is 0.36 times sigma yield. Sigma ultimate, I should adopt minimum among these two values. So if I solve, I will get 0.6 into sigma yield is 235.4, which is nothing but 141.24 MPa. 0.36 into 425 is nothing but 153 megapascals. So minimum among these two is 141.24. So therefore, sigma max is 141.24 megapascals. Now, considering the keyway effect, percent of strength is lost, so therefore sigma allowable is 75% of sigma max. So 141.24 into 75%, it yields us 106 megapascals. So we have calculated both tau allowable and sigma allowable. Now I can determine the diameter by using both maximum shear stress theory as well as by using maximum normal stress theory. And also for minor shocks from table 3.1a, for minor shocks, the value of CM and CT, that is fatigue and shock correction factors, are CM varies from 1.5 to 2, so therefore I will take it as 1.75, and CT varies from 1 to 1.5, therefore I will take it as 1.25 average values. Now for solid shaft, we know that the value of diameter ratio is 0. So let us find the diameter. Now first one, from maximum shear stress theory, we know that diameter of the shaft is given by 16 by pi tau allowable into square root of CM MB square plus CT MT square into 1 by 1 minus k to the power of 4 whole to the power of 1/3, that is V is equal to 16 by 5 times tau allowable is 53 into square root of CM is 1.75 into MB is 1602831 square, plus CT is 1.25 into MT is 397125 square. Substituting K as 0, you get it as unity whole to the power of 1/3. So therefore, according to maximum shear stress theory, the diameter is 64.929. So therefore, I can adopt 65 millimeters. Second one is from maximum normal stress theory. You know that diameter of the shaft is given by D is equal to 16 by pi sigma allowable into CM MB plus square root of CM MB square plus CT MT square into 1 by 1 minus k to the power of 4 whole to the power of 1/3. So therefore, if I substitute all the values and calculate, I get the value of diameter as D is equal to 16 by pi into 106 into CM is 1.75 MB is 1602831 plus square root of 1.75 into 1602831 square. Plus under the root continuing which CT is 1.25 into MT is 397125 whole to the power of 1/3. So therefore, diameter will be, diameter is equal to 64.763, which is nothing but 65 mm. So therefore, adopt D is equal to 65 millimeters. So this is the complete solution for problem number 3. In this problem, we have solved for diameter of the shaft in which we have mountings of pulleys. In our next lecture, I will take up mountings of gears on the shafts and I will explain how to solve such problems. That's all from this lecture. Thank you all.